Welcome to the CWA Radio Network, brought to you by Christian Women Affiliate. You're listening to a-musing, hosted by me, Heather Randall. What if every thought is deeper than a daydream? What if it's a seedling from our Heavenly Father, our one true muse, pointing us to something we need to know? Let's embrace the freedom to wonder, take the invitation to explore, and learn everything He has to teach us in this amazing journey of life. After the show, we invite you to join us at ChristianWomenAffiliate.com. Let's get this show started.
Hello and happy Friday. Well, most people start over in January. They set goals, they make resolutions, and they attempt to begin fresh. My January felt a bit like a rumbling continuation of December. You know what I mean? Everything just sort of ran together. My days were lumped up to the point that I had to check my calendar just to know what day of the week it was. Have you ever been there? Well, I was functioning on empty. I was drained. I wasn't ready for 2016 to start. I wasn't ready to do what God was telling me I'd have to do this year. I was stalled by fear. I mentioned in my last episode that my daughter was going to be having surgery, and I asked for prayer for that, and many of you have prayed, and I thank you for that so much. On January 18th, my daughter Chloe had decompression surgery to correct her Chiari malformation. It meant anesthesia, an incision on the back of her neck, a six-hour surgery on her brain, removal of her C1, bovine grafts, stitches, a seven-day hospital stay, and medicine. Lots of medicine. It was scary. Everything leading up to the surgery was a blur. It's still a blur. Then we were at the hospital with nothing left to do but wait. Wait and abide. And there a peace finally washed over me. After surgery, we had the haze of healing, the taste of hospital food, and an outpouring of love and support from friends that still touches my heart. Post-surgery, my girlie is doing well, very well. Her recovery has been painful at times, but she's strong. She doesn't let anything stop her. Her incision is healing beautifully, and the fear that started my year has made my faith stronger on the other side. So January flew by. But I knew my word for 2016 immediately. Do you have a word for the year? Have you seen people who do that? Well, I do that. And I saw the word on a banner, and it stuck in my heart like glue. God kept flashing that image, whispering quietly, "Abide." It's hard to abide when you feel unworthy to be in His presence, tired or filled with fear. At the beginning of the year, I was all of those things. I felt so unsure of my relationship with God because I was in such turmoil. Such fear had gripped me for my child that I didn't know what was up and what was down. I couldn't see God in the middle of that fear. I couldn't see God in that situation. It's hard to abide when the noise of life is drowning out your quiet time. It's even harder to abide when you aren't in Him, when you are separated or unaware of His love, when your brain can't fathom a God at all. I'm starting clean with a-musing. I'm bringing it back to where this show started. It was always meant to be reflection. I want meat in each episode for adult listeners to chew on. But it was also supposed to be for families. I always planned it that way. And I was actually operating with the intent, originally, of reaching out to homeschool families and somewhere along the way, I left the children out, and I want to invite them back. And so I'm going to start by including a new segment of the show. I want to invite you to take a listen And I'll be back after this.
Welcome to Smart Small Ones, the child-led portion of a-musing, where my children jump in and share their views, inspiring your children to think through our topic. Meet your hosts,
Chloe,
Kaylee,
Nevi,
and
Sadie.
Let's get growing in God.
Are you ready for this, Nevi?
Yes.
Nevi is 10 years old, and I'm going to start first with a scripture. And the scripture is Acts 17, verse 28, and it says, "For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring." Now, Nevi, I'm going to ask you, what does it mean to be in him?
Well, it means to walk in his word every day, to try your best at everything. He would be very happy then, and then you could walk in him, and that's what I think it means.
Good answer. Now, when we're in something, when we're inside of something, or when we're in it, it becomes part of us too, right? You said, you had told me earlier when I told you your question, you said, well, he's in us too, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so he's in us and we're in him. So we're kind of all lumped together, so much so that if you put water into water and you shake it all up, it's still water, right?
Yes.
So he's different, mm-hmm. But we're made in his image, right? He's holy. And when we put him inside of us and we shake it all up, we should become more like him, right? Okay, so we're supposed to be more like him, and so much like him that you can't tell us apart, right? When the world looks at us, they should see what?
God.
Yep, they should see him in us. Okay, thank you.
And that was Smart Small Ones. The foundation for anything else that we do in Christ begins with salvation. The path to being in him so completely meshed with his vision for us and walking in his ways has its first stop at repentance. We have to start with that blank slate. We have to seek forgiveness for our old ways of thinking, our old patterns of behavior, and our attempts at acting apart from him. We have to get in step with his word. We have to obey. Sacrificing your life, laying it on an altar, and surrendering your heart is a beautiful, important thing. But it's not everything. The Bible says in Proverbs 21, verse 3, "To do what is right and just is more acceptable to the Lord than sacrifice." 1 Samuel 15:22 through 23 says, "Does the Lord delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as much as in obeying the voice of the Lord? To obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed is better than the fat of rams. For rebellion is like the sin of divination, and arrogance like the evil of idolatry." God instructed burnt sacrifices and the sacrificial system for a purpose. Understand that there are many offerings in Scripture, and it's not really my focus today to name or explain them all, but to explain the verse I just read, I want to touch on the burnt sacrifice just a little bit. The Hebrew word for burnt offering is olah, from the root ayin lamed hey, meaning ascension. The word is linked to submission, to ascend to God, to be in his presence. They had to submit. This offering was a sort of physical demonstration of submission. Now this sacrifice, unlike some of the others, was open to everyone, Jews and Gentiles alike. So it included everyone, because to come to God, whatever your religious background, you must first submit your life to him. This is still very much the case today. To have a relationship with God, you first must submit your life to him. In 1 Samuel 15:22 through 23, we see that there is a sacrifice that outweighs and overpowers the burnt offering, or the act of submission, and that is obedience. You can submit without obeying. You can lay it down and walk back to your old life. Or you can lay it down in true submission and walk it out in obedience. God, from his word, clearly prefers our obedience. He wants us to be like him. That means that pride and rebellion, they just have to stop. We have to listen to him. We listen by being in his word, through prayer, and by careful examination of what we hear from him on a personal level. Now, if you don't know how to listen to God, or you don't know what I mean when I say hearing from God, I have an episode on hearing God that I've linked up below in the show description. So if you're unsure what I mean on this topic, please give it a listen. But today I want to talk about the person, adult or child, that has not come into relationship with Christ yet. I want you to know that you don't have to be good enough to come to him. You can come broken and trust that he'll mold you into something healthier and more authentic. He always knew you, even before your birth. He knit you up in your mother's womb. He knew you inside and out. He knew what you could become. He saw the potential that you can't even see right now. Who we can be gets corrupted by sin. It's happened to all of us. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And when we sin, we alter the course with free will, and we stray from our design. We can get pretty scrambled. But God still remembers the plans he has for us. He still has the outline for you. He knows who you really are at your core. And if you surrender to him and let him into your heart so he can be in you and you can be in him, well then, you will become that true design again. You become more like him. You become who you were always meant to be. And that is when things change for the better. Oh, now don't get me wrong. Walking in him is not always cushy. He'll tell you to abide when your insides are screaming. He'll want you to move when you want to rest. He'll ask you to surrender when your flesh wants to cling. He'll take you places that will challenge you. He'll take you to the brink. At the beginning of January, I was at the brink. I was scared for my daughter. I wasn't just scared for her to be well on the other side of surgery. I was afraid for the surgery. I was afraid of losing my baby. It was scary. And when you're in a situation of fear like that, that's so gripping and so huge, it's hard to find rest. It's hard to trust. From the moment that I knew that I'd conceived her, I began praying for this child. And I prayed for every detail of her body. I prayed for every part of her, from her head to her feet. I prayed for her health of every organ that I could think to name. I prayed over specific areas of attack that I knew my family had been through in the past, so that she could be free of any family curses or any damage that was done in the past in the family line. I wanted her to have a clean slate. And here she was, anyway. Here she was, needing surgery on her brain. And I was terrified. See, I've been in this place before. I've been in the same exact position where I've prayed for somebody. From the top of their head to the soles of their feet, inside out, for all their passions, for all their dreams and goals, for their health. I prayed for every organ. I had done this before. I did it for my brother-in-law. And a year ago, he passed away. Things don't always work out the way we want them to, just because we're in God. Sometimes they hurt. Sometimes you're going to get to the very end of you. He will take you to the brink, where everything you feel gets so big inside that you can hardly see Him. It happens to believers too. But friend, when you get to the edge of hope, and all you see is darkness, death, and fear, when your faith wants to run, like mine did, when your insides flip and your trust starts to waver, He'll be there. I know this. He'll be on the inside, holding onto your heart, steadying you when you don't know what to do. He'll listen to you rant. Boy, did I ever rant. I asked God, where are you in this? I asked that with my daughter, and I asked that with my brother-in-law. I said, God, where are you in this? He'll take your anger, too, if you keep respect. He's a big God. And you know what? He's big enough to complain to. He's big enough to take my whining. And boy, can I whine sometimes. He's big enough to take your complaints and your whines and your fears and your insecurities and everything else you bring to the table, because He just wants you there. He'll let you feel alone for a moment. And then He'll whisper. He'll whisper, I will never leave you or forsake you. So yeah, it will be a rocky walk. You'll mess up. You'll fall. Keep getting up. He desires you. He wants you to be in Him. God wants to see you reflecting His power, displaying peace even in terrifying situations when peace is unexplainable. He wants to see you demonstrating love to the unlovable and uniting with His dreams for you. He wants you in relationship with Him, but that's something only you can choose. Are you ready to make that choice? I hope so. Let's pray. But I'm going to give you a few minutes of silence first. Now, I won't go anywhere. I'm sitting right here in the studio praying for you. I don't want to feed you lines or make you repeat after me. You know how to talk. Just speak from your heart like you're talking to a friend, because He truly wants to be that for you. Are you ready? Okay. Thank you, Father God, for wanting us to be in you. Thank you for this listener, whoever they are, that you've laid on my heart today. Thank you for their decision to let you in. And I pray that they would lay it all down, every bit. I pray blessings on their future and protection on their walk with you. God, I pray that they would see you even in the darkest moments. That they wouldn't be afraid to whine or cry, or call out. That you would be always there. Make their faith solid and keep talking to them through your word. Father, make it alive like never before. Make it real and applicable to their life. In your name we pray. Amen. Now you, my friend, are part of the in crowd in the most important way. You are popular with the King of Kings, and right now they're cheering for you in heaven. He is in you, and you are in him. Stay in that place. Don't let anything shake you from it. Don't let any temptation rock the boat. Don't let any fear grip your heart. Before I go, I want to leave you with one more scripture and a thought to chew on. 1 Peter 1:14 warns us, "As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance." Basically, what it's saying is, don't behave in a way that you did before you learned the truth. Make it a habit of being obedient. Remember that when temptations come, he's with you. Lean on him. Call on him. Next week, we are continuing our in series by talking about how to be in love God's way. So join me right here next week at 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 4 p.m. Central Standard Time on the CWA Radiant Network. Be blessed.